appropriate response to beauty. Thank you, Heather and friend, for the gift of beauty there. Excellent. Great clue from our good God. Well, good morning. Welcome to Trinity Church. Great to see each and every one of you here. Now, for the just a little family business, for the next 2 weeks, our lead pastor is out of town. So next week, Josh Spires, who's planting the church in Abundant Mercy, will be up preaching. So Pastor Mark's scheduled to be back in 3 weeks. And it happens to be a great time to be on a cruise ship in the Pacific, which is where he currently is right now with his dear wife and extended family. So if you see me up here in 3 weeks, we can pray for our pastor who will be pastoring on a ship or somewhere on the West Coast, returning from the Pacific. But it's great to see you here this morning. It's my privilege to serve Christ in our church. My name's Tony. Just excited to kick off this series together today. Want to begin with a story. A couple months ago, Allie and I had the gift of quality time. We both like quality time. It's one of our top love languages. So we had quality time with my 90-year-young grandma, Grandma Josie. She doesn't live around here, so we had the meal. We had good conversation. We made a fun dessert. And toward the end of that night, we had a full weekend together. We turned on the TV. Now, this was in January, and it was a historic day, I guess, if you follow this kind of stuff, because I was flipping through the channels, and Grandma Josie's over here. I'm sitting over here. And we get to this thing in Washington, D.C., this trial. And it was like that day that that trial was decided. So Grandma looks over at me in a sweet voice and just goes, "Tony, are you for Truman?" And before I could respond, she did what you just did. She starts laughing. Allie's laughing. I'm laughing. For those of you who don't know, Harry S. Truman was the 33rd president in 1945. He served in World War I in 1918. Yes, Grandma Josie, I'm for Harry S. Truman. I'm going to gently walk away from politics with this week, with all that's happening. But I need a little more engagement today, this morning, before we get kicked off, if you don't mind. So I got here, you see this guy. We're going to use this a little bit today, so bear with me. You're going to notice I was clearly hired for my handwriting skills, my drawing skills at Trinity Church. I'm going to write down one word, and I want to hear 5 different voices. Introverts, you're welcome to apply. The first thing you think of, to keep this as a good social experiment, I need to know the first things you think of when you see this word. So here we go. Here's the first one. Say it out loud. What do you think of?
Vacation.
Vacation. What else?
Team.
Money. Mundane. Money. One more.
Stress.
Good. All right, let's do one more for those of you that didn't get it in. That is an S and an S. And you can see my staff team, they really love when I pull out the whiteboard. All right, one more. Ready? Ready? B. O-S-S. 5 words.
Nice.
Leader.
Taskmaster.
Now the first service said wife. Wife right away. So, and we just finished the marriage series. I mean, wow, we're applying God's word, you know? What's up with you guys though? We got 2 more. What else?
Smart,
one more.
Lazy.
Fun, this is fun. Because watch this, you're going to love this, okay? Vacation and work, that means a negative. Team is a positive. Mundane is definitely a negative. Money, if you ask Jesus, it's a negative, but it's also a plus. Stress, clearly a negative. Nice is a positive, it's good to have a nice boss and a good leader. But a taskmaster, that sounds negative. Smart's definitely a positive. Lazy's a negative. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. We'll tip the scales with 6. This room is 60% negative. We are 60% negative when it comes to work. Employee engagement studies out there by HR maybe would say even more about this. This is just a little fun experiment. But is this really what we were created for? 60% negative, even if you want to say 50% negative or 40% negative. I mean, who's ultimately responsible for work and a boss?
Do we blame God? In this country, we are negative when it comes to work at a boss. I'll never forget being on a mission trip overseas in the country of Turkey as a young man, college student. And I was with several young ladies, Americans, and we're on this trip. And you would have no idea how unique it is to be an American until you go to a foreign country. Because every single one of those young ladies got proposals to get married by Turkish men. So the 40 and 50 and 60-year-old Turkish men could come work in our country because they're going to be a good husband to these 18-year-olds, they promised. Every single one got a marriage proposal of some kind. And yet here we are in the richest, this great rich empire, and we're 60% negative. And people want to come here, they want to work here, they want to serve here. What's going on with this? Here's what I think is going on with this, is who you work for makes all the difference. We are created for much more than all this negativity. We're going to look at the creation story today, and God never intended it to be 60% negative. That was not his good plan when he blessed us all, blessed us as men and women, and blessed us with work and with calling and vocation. It's never his plan. But who you and I work for makes all the difference. If we're positive, if we're negative, we could get back just briefly and delicately into the politics thing. If you asked Harry S. Truman's administration, Donald J. Trump's administration, any president, any boss, any of your bosses, do they make a positive or a negative impact on their employees and on the workplace? It makes all the difference who you work for. And so I don't want to go and think we only work for ourselves, for our little kingdoms, our money, or for a certain company that inspires us or doesn't, for a boss that's lazy or that's smart or that's nice or that's a taskmaster. We ultimately work for God. It's in his good plan, we'll see, as we dive into this creation story. So it's a work series where we're saying stay humble, hustle hard, that our work does matter, whether you find it meaningful or mundane. Whatever description you have, there's an invitation, there's a response that God gives us in his good work. And I think we'll be encouraged today that who we work for makes all the difference. That we're called to work for God, and that's a good thing. It's a plus difference in an impact of this world, not in a negative way, but in a powerful and good way. So let's pray together. God, we don't want to be 60% negative. Help us, looking back at this creation story and through what your work is doing in this world, help us see and experience your grace and truth this morning in such an important area of life. We pray this, God, in your name. Amen. So I want to start off reading that very first creation story together this morning. So I'm going to read in Genesis chapter 1, starting in verse 26. Then God said, "Let us make mankind in our image, in our likeness, so that they may rule over the fish in the sea and the birds in the sky, over the livestock and all the wild animals, and over all the creatures that move along the ground." So God created mankind in his own image. In the image of God, he created them. Male and female, he created them. God blessed them and said to them, "Be fruitful and increase in number. Fill the earth and subdue it. Rule over the fish in the sea and the birds in the sky and over every living creature that moves on the ground." We see right from the beginning that God creates good work. It's blessed. It's given these commands to be fruitful, to multiply, to rule, to reign, to do work. It doesn't come from the fall. Men and women, equally made in God's image, are equally invited into the work of the world. There's some differences that you see, but a whole lot of similarities, given the job description, given that we all share 99.9% of the same DNA. There's uniqueness and there's blessing. There's oneness implied that men and women work in the world in these unique ways with this job description to fill the earth, not just procreation. This implies, okay, if we have fruits over here and vegetables over here, how do we all work together in filling this earth and pruning these gardens? Do we plant something over here? What do we do over there? There's a uniqueness, there's a blessing, there's an order, there's an ability to get creative in that garden of old. The rule and subdue is actually a command that I see in this, what we just read, of what God did in the creation story. God took a earth that was formless and void, and he ruled, he created, he subdued, he added things. He did unique things to add and create everything. But only humans are given a job description. One scholar says, only man and woman is set apart and given a job description. I like that. Only you and I. The animals, they don't have our job description. They're not out there trying to rule, subdue, create new things, find cures for new viruses that scare us, all those sort of things. They're not busy doing that. They're just doing their animal type things. You and I have that uniqueness. And so what I see here is this is not a punishment, but it's a responsibility. So we're created for more, and we can see from the beginning, we're created with more for more responsibility. More than just the average bear that's out there. You and I are created for more responsibilities over the whole creation. Work is a part of that creation. We're created for more in that way. So I encourage you in that this morning. And so far we see the story, even though we're 60% negative here, it's all good so far. It's a good creation. It's blessed. We're given a clear command on what to do. But if you know the rest of the story, it definitely takes a turn. So we're going to go into that reality of creation and fall. So looking at Genesis 3:17 through 19, this is in particular about work and how it affects all of us. To Adam he said, "Because you listened to your wife and ate fruit from the tree about which I commanded you, you must not eat from it. Cursed is the ground because of you. Through painful toil you will eat food from it all the days of your life. It'll produce thorns and thistles for you, and you will eat the plants of the field. By the sweat of your brow you will eat your food until you return to the ground, since from it you were taken. For dust you are, and to dust you will return." Ooh. Now we see why we're 60% negative. Thorns and thistles and toil, blood, sweat, and tears. It's as if this is a tree. It's a good tree. But the story takes a turn. They were meant to be in this garden to rule and multiply and create and to care, to subdue and to fill. And yet ashes to ashes, dust to dust, Adam and Eve end up here. God creates and we fall. They don't listen. They don't listen ultimately to God. And there's a fall from that. There's pain from that. There's evil from the sin that is now baked into the creation super deep. So deep that we don't know the origins of this, that something in China with ruling and creating, ruling over animals, and something with animals perhaps, and this new disease and this scare, baked even into the creation, not alone our own bodies and hearts and wills, but just the fall and the effects of this. Thorns and thistles. You see, in the earlier curse to Eve, there's now more pain in childbirth. Studying this, I was like, oh, wow, there actually seems to be a bit of pain in childbirth even in the garden. But now it's serious. Now it can lead to death of women. So many women in this room probably have lost a baby en route to delivery and suffered miscarriage at some point along the way. The fall. Men and women have sweat and blood and tears at work and tough stuff at work, thus our boss list. Ouch. Now, thankfully, the story doesn't stop here. Even though God said, if you eat from this fruit, you will certainly die, they don't die right away. I want to go back to the story for a second. Watch this. Then the man and his wife heard the sound of the Lord God as he was walking in the garden in the cool of the day. And they hid from the Lord God among the trees. They hide from God because of sin. What does God do with sin? But the Lord God called to the man, "Where are you?" We sin and we hide, and God moves toward us. Where are you today? We sin, we struggle at work, there's thorns and thistles, and God moves toward us. Where are you? He calls by name. So even though we fall, God still calls. This is not the end of the story. We wouldn't all exist here if this was the end of the story, that we just die instantly. Adam and Eve die instantly. Creation's gone, at least the human beings. There's no more be fruitful and multiply, no more call to that. The story continues. Now the creation is different, and there's pain, and there's suffering, and there's thorns and thistles, but now, y'all know what the circles mean, right? That means like a little baby. So those are just little babies. Because they had a bunch of them. They filled the earth. They were fruitful and multiplied. They were able to get food still from the ground. Even though there's pain from it, they were able to create lots. And I want you to see this pattern because I think it's really important as we go through this whole series on work to understand from the very beginning of the creation story and then this other pattern of, okay, there's lots of people. There's been a filling of the earth. Let's just do it times 10,000. And God looks at this 10,000 well past Adam and Eve. There's creation, they're being fruitful and multiplying. Okay, that's so far so good. But God looks and he sees sin and evil and violence. So much so that he's going to bring, not a virus, but a big rainstorm. See that nice cloud? I'm telling you, I got hired for my drawing skills. Big flood's going to come. God creates, we fall, everyone's going to die, make it a huge tomb. Oh no. But God still calls. It's not the end of the story. Because let's do a nice ark. Is that a nice ark? Let's put a sailboat on it. That help? Because there's one guy and his family, and I'm going to give him listening ears. Unlike Eve, unlike Adam, it says in Genesis 6:22 that Noah did exactly as God had commanded him to do. He's going to listen, unlike Adam and Eve. He's going to listen to God's command. And the story of us continues. God creates, we fall, but God still calls. And God still has a plan. You just got to see this a little more, okay? So then the story continues in Genesis, and you have Abraham and Sarah. Now, they are older. You can tell by their bodies, right? You see older bodies? Can you tell? We'll draw the grave a little closer, if you don't mind, because they're pretty old in age. So they're experiencing the fall. God creates the fall. They're getting old. And God still calls, and he actually calls them in a weird way to move and to make a baby, but they're old, and so they kind of laugh and kind of respond, and eventually, though, the story continues, and they do have a baby. It's pretty amazing. And that baby has twins. Pretty awesome. And the twins, from one of the twins, you get 12 babies, which is pretty cool. 12 sons. And sure enough, all of a sudden it looks like, be fruitful and multiply. And God promised this couple that if they listened and trusted him and obeyed him, that they would have so many great, 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 great grandchildren to be like stars in the sky. It's pretty awesome. And God's working through this story of his creation still to be fruitful and multiply through this unique people of Israel. And it's good, although we see still some fall and drama and exodus and exile. One last garden for you. Because this 12 happens again. Except for this time it's 12 men. And this time, actually it's 11. And the story takes a turn. Because we're in a garden, but it's not the Garden of Eden. We're in a different garden, and it's a time of prayer and a time of seeking. And I don't know how many of you caught this one. It's a little abstract, it seems like, at first. When he had finished praying, Jesus left with his disciples and crossed the Kidron Valley. On the other side, there was a garden, and he and his disciples went into it. Now, Judas, who betrayed him, knew the place because Jesus had often met there with his disciples. And if you know the story, Judas slithers his way into the garden and betrays Jesus. And there's a fall. And whether it's Judas or Adam and Eve or me, I sin, I fall. All have sinned, Scripture says. All are part of this story. And so even though we fall, God still calls Christ to this earth. And ultimately, Christ goes to a cross. And it looks like, is this the end of the story? But 3 days later, you have what's never happened before at any funeral in human history. You have an empty tomb. And he's come back in the very same body that he died in, even with the scars on his body. Because he's not just a man. He's not just an Adam. He's not just a Noah or an Abraham. He's God. And he died for you and for me. And the whole world is actually not headed toward hell in a handbasket. I don't know where we get the handbasket part on that. But the whole world is actually headed toward a new creation. Oh, this is my new world. A new heaven and a new earth. Jesus gets a new body, a resurrected body. You and I get to head toward a new creation. It's not headed toward death. Ultimately, it's headed toward resurrection. And that's where in the Southern Church they say amen. Because there's implications for you and I when we die, because we still face this curse of we're going to go to dust. So why do we work? Why do we have purpose? Because God invites us to work with him, to be a servant of his in his creation story that ultimately is headed toward new life, toward a new heaven, a new earth. I get to identify in Christ with his crucified body, and then now I get to be a new man, a new creation with him forever. No matter if I get a virus, no matter if I get in a car wreck, no matter how, I don't know how my story ends, but I get to be with God. It's a new work. And amazingly, when God calls, he calls us into this new work that he is doing. I get to be a part of it. You get to be a part of it. In fact, we're all essential in this story, even though the focus certainly is Christ and his work and the good news of where the world is headed. You have a role to play. I have a role to play. So we can't retire early on this side of the new heaven and new earth. There's work to be done. We're called to it, even though we're imperfect, even though there's a fall. It's a great way to start a new week, to start a new week together. Every Sunday is a new day, a resurrection day. Not the end of the week, not just a day of rest, but a day of celebration of God, of who he is, that he responds to this fall issue with compassion, with love, with sending Christ to each and every one of us. This is helpful, I hope. I hope for you to see the big picture as we get into more specifics of application throughout this whole series and look at important texts, that God has a plan that he's working out, and it's not just creation and it's not just fall. You could say it's redemption. You could say it's resurrection. He's got a good plan, a creative plan ahead. So how do we access this, you and I, is more responsibility, point one, but more, we're created for more than just responsibility. That can feel heavy, but more faith. More faith. We were created for more. We were created to have faith in God, to have a relationship with God. I'm going to define faith as having the courage to listen and obey God. Noah and Abraham, and especially Jesus, listened and obeyed the Father. And Jesus said this in the garden, that how must the scriptures be fulfilled? It has to be this way, even though he's facing the fall and seeing violence and about to go face a horrific death. Romans 10, it says, faith comes from hearing, and hearing God's word, our listening, our faith to hear from God. Oh, work feels heavy today. Work feels heavy tomorrow. Choose to listen to God. Choose to go into work by faith, even if your body's aging or tired or you're afraid or there's conflict or there's uncertainty about the work environment you're in. Choose to listen and do what God would do in your setting, in your place. Listen to his unique voice. Come in with more faith. I know there's so much thorns and thistles, right? Just for a moment of compassion of what you face. Face a lot in the workplace and your work identity. Maybe in your marriage, maybe it's he works too much or she works too much. She doesn't work at all. He spends too much money. Maybe you're a young person here today. What am I going to do with my career? My parents are too involved, too pushy about my summer job, or they're not involved at all. They don't care. I'll just play video games. Get a job playing video games one day. There's all kinds of struggles of the thorns and thistles, the responsibilities. Maybe your work gives you so much time off. Maybe they don't give you enough time off. Maybe people don't care about the time off because no one's motivated. There's no seemingly greater impact or purpose in what you're doing. There's all kinds of things that you can face in the fall, but God still calls. Where are you? Hey, calls you by name. Follow Jesus. Follow me. Serve Christ. You have a purpose. You have gifts and talents that no one else in human history has, a unique combination of skills and talents and authority to rule and to reign still, even with an imperfect body, because of what God is doing in the world. There's one point in my career, and probably we all have had these, where we think, oh man, I'm just quitting, and I'm going to go do something totally different. I thought REI sounds pretty good, just to like sell technical gear. And thankfully, as I walked that out just a little bit, I didn't walk away from ministry. I've, I've only known 15 plus years of professional ministry. It's all I've ever known. Done some other things, been able to do some creative business things on the side with friends that's been neat, but I'm going to walk away. But who do I work for? What is his good plan? How can I serve him? And he's guided me through those steps. And I would have missed today. I don't want to miss today. I love our church. I love God's word. I love being with you. So I encourage you, no matter what you face in the thorns and thistles, to have more faith. More faith this week as you go to work. I want to just work through some applications here of ways that you and I, because we're created for more, ways that we can honor God. And it's hard to get involved in this story in a way, because we don't create a new world. There's no way you or I could die on the cross for anyone else's sins, because we're sinners. We can't make a new heaven and a new earth. But there actually are access points to what God is doing in his work that he invites again us into. So I want to put up some and just get really practical for a few minutes, if you don't mind. And the practicalities relate to creation, fall, redemption. First, creativity. And if you hear any of these and you want to steal them, good. You probably have some great ideas too. But creativity. Invent something new. What if this week you just started a new project? What if you walked into your supervisor and said, I want to go this direction. We've talked about these goals or this effort. I'm going to get creative. What about this industry? Or what about this product? Or what about these clients? He just came in with some creativity, because God's made you with creative gifts. What if you went out and invented the cure to the coronavirus this week? And then we got creative, you told us about it, and we would invest with you in your company. Right? There's a potential, human potential, so much gift of mind and new ideas and talent. So invent something new this week, create something new. That's one encouragement. Another one is keep your heart and your soul in rhythm. Just encourage you to get creative about this, about your body. So if you put your hand on your heart right now, there's a rhythm. There's a beat. It's a gift. We actually get, on average, 650,000 of these. Not heartbeats, but hours. Total. That's on average. If you live to 70-something, whatever that is. You get 650,000 hours. Most or some in this room over your whole career will earn more money then you actually have hours to live. That's humbling before we go to the dust. But get creative about your rhythms of that, because my heart's in rhythm right now, but if I work all of these hours, I'm going to die, because I got to sleep, I got to eat. It's good to have abundant life in other places. And if I never work, I might get down too. So either extreme, get in rhythm. God's rhythm was 6 days work, 1 day rest. In Christ, I do think there's freedom if you do 7 days work, 7 days work, 7 days work. Just get in rhythm. Have a little bit of rest. If you're not working at all and maybe you need some encouragement, just to take a few steps and see the workplace in the home, the workplace in retirement, the workplace at your job, some small successes. Get around people who will cheer you on to utilize those hours for Jesus in awesome ways. If you're young, you can try many jobs, different summer internships, get around different talented people in our church. There's all kinds of ways that you can get creative about that. So those are just some thoughts on creativity. You probably bring a lot more. I hope they encourage you. When it relates to the fall, compassion, God still moves toward us, even when we sin. So I want to encourage you to spiritually prepare for work would be another one. Get the day started with compassion, not with like, oh, gotta go to work. Start with some love together. So one of the ways I try and do this as a family, because my kids are going to work, they're going to school, is let's pray together the Lord's Prayer. I do a kid's version of the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who's in all the skies, please come down and be our King. Please do whatever you want to do everywhere. Please give everybody the food they need. Please forgive us the bad stuff we've done. We're trying to forgive others their bad stuff. Please keep us from wanting to do more bad stuff. Yes, save us from the devil and from evil. In Jesus' name, amen. How long did that just take? You can prepare your family for work spiritually every day. We say that as we drive to the bus stop. There might be other things that you want to add in, because work is heavy, because there's a fall, but you can spiritually prepare and prepare your family, prepare your heart and soul for that. You may choose to fast. Some of you do this in different ways. You abstain from certain things during the work week to focus. I try in, as a family, another family example of work. We do no technology Thursdays. My kids love it. Dad, can I watch TV? No. Dad, can we play this video game? No. We play. I love it. We play board games. Get outside, hopefully. But we're that part of that rhythm of the fall is here, and so we gotta just we want to end the week strong, and we want to focus. We don't want to get too lost in all of the pull toward that kind of stuff. Maybe you do different things. Alcoholism, I'll just be honest, runs in my family, so I do certain things with alcohol or with desserts, just to have a little fast from the fall and the rhythm of those things that can pull us away from the more of God toward the more of anything addictive or anything that's harmful to our bodies, to our hearts, to our souls. I encourage you, another one, just one last one on the fall, when it comes to compassion, is reconcile regularly. This is a tough one. In fact, when I came into this role, it was really important to me in our staff playbook to say, hey, reconciliation is one of our plays within 24 to 48 hours of our playbook. Execute the play, team member. Hopefully I do this. Where if there's a bump, someone can come up to me and, hey, Tony, when you led this meeting, when you directed us to this goal, when I shared this and you shared that, oh, that hurt my feelings, or this seems off, or this seems too much. And then I should hopefully stay humble, hustle hard, listen, and reconcile. And we ask that we do that with each other within 48 hours of a meeting or a discussion. At least log it and circle back to it. So that way, for you and I in the workplace, if you got 5 or 10 years of sins on your boss, all counted up, and yet Christ, it says, he, not counting people's sins against them, that he reconciled the world to himself. God doesn't count our sins. He doesn't keep a scoreboard. Why should we? Reconcile regularly. You can do this in Christ. I encourage you in that. Finally, in redemption of a changed world, that this is just good work. More faith to see what God is doing through Christ, redeeming the world. I encourage you to just get energized by other people. It happens to me even in the preaching moment where I come up and we have some laughs together, you encourage me. And I bet when you go to your office, there's certain people you just love to meet with, connect with, teams that you go to, that I could come in with a little bit of, oh, work day. And yet, to see that Christ is changing the world, and I get around our staff, different laughter, different ideas, different thoughts, and they energize me, they encourage me. That happens, I hope, at your workplace. If not, you can be the leader. You can be the instigator of the whole world's headed to resurrection, to new life, and you get to be a part of it this day. God has made, that God has gifted you in. I got to do this, I'm going to brag on a group, they don't even, may not even know it's coming, was walking down the hallway on Thursday, and the door was shut, and there's an awesome group of ladies that meet here for a Bible study, for a small group. The door was shut, and they're singing praises up to God. They were singing hymns. They've never seen Jesus in the flesh. And they're singing to their invisible good God amidst their worship. And I stop. And I'm energized by their faith. That, okay, it's preaching week. It's a good day. They're worshiping. I'm going to worship today. Encourage one another. Because this stuff can be 60% negative. And yet our good God, who has reconciled the whole world through Christ, calls you and calls me to work, to serve. And our labor in the Lord is never in vain. Amen. Amen. Let's pray. God, your story is a good story. It gives us hope, Christ, that you rose from the dead. That you didn't even get 650,000 hours on this planet, Jesus. Your life was cut short because of sin and because of the fall. And yet there's a new world that you're making, and we get to be a part of it because we were created for more to be with you. Thank you, Jesus, for more responsibility, that we're not like the animals out there just doing their thing, that we could gather and learn and grow and share and lead and impact and inspire other people. Thank you, God, for more faith, for Abraham and Sarah, for Noah, for so many witnesses who listened and did as you said, who exercised courageous listening and obedience. Help us to do that, God, in our workplaces. God, you know where it's really heavy, where it's really thorny, where in the home, in the schools, in the workplace, in retirement, looking at certain things, God, where the worries are, where the pain points are. Help us respond today, God, with more faith in that. May we join in your great story with creativity and compassion, and ultimately seeing a changed world, Christ, in you. Would you do a deep work in us through this series? This is humbling, God, that we only get so much time. But amidst that, God, we thank you that there is hope in you. There's the Holy Spirit's power in you. There's ability to love our neighbor, to love our coworkers and our supervisors and our calling in you. Help us and redeem that in this series, we humbly ask. Look to you today for your grace, Christ, and your truth. We pray this, Jesus, in the only powerful and resurrected name on this planet, in Jesus, in your name.